In this module, we have investigated the possibility of using work energy principle to solving problems where we are relating forces with displacement and speed or the velocity. In doing so, we have also defined the concept of work done by certain kinds of forces. We have defined the concept of kinetic energy and how the work done by forces relate to kinetic energy or change in kinetic energy. So now we're in a good position to write down a general method for solving problems using work energy approach. So the first step in this method is to apply a test. Okay, so what is a test? The test has two parts. The first part is to recognize that the problem involves finite displacement. So you have a particle over here, and then this particle moves from this position to another position. Okay, so this could be initial position, this could be the final position, and it has moved by a certain distance. There are certain forces acting on it. Okay, let's say F1, F2, and so on. And you're trying to relate the velocity in initial position with the final position velocity. So there is a finite displacement scenario in the problem given to you. So that's part one of the test. So if it is positive, if there is a finite displacement, then that means that maybe there is a possibility you can use a work energy approach. The second part of the test is that you are only relating forces with displacement and speed. Okay, so if the question is asking for acceleration, that doesn't mean that you cannot apply work energy principle. You may still be able to apply work energy principle to maybe a part of the problem, but to compute the acceleration, you would have no choice but to use Newton's second law, which is sigma f equal to ma. Okay, so you will see certain examples where we will apply both the principles. So we'll apply Newton's second law, from which the work energy principle is derived, but we can definitely use both of them in combination as well. And the biggest advantage of using work energy principle is that the work energy equation is a scalar equation, so you don't have to deal with vector equations. Okay, so that's step number one. Now, if this test is positive, then we can move on to next step. And that's step two. So step two is choose coordinate system, and this is something we have been doing time and again, and show it. Step three is, let me write over here, show it along with position variables. So if you have one particle, you'll have one position variable. For one degree of freedom system, if you have two particles, you may have two position variables, and so on. Okay, then the step three is do as much kinematic analysis as you can. And the goal is to get the speeds. Okay, so if you can find the speeds directly from the kinematic analysis, that's great. If you can find the speed directly, at least you want to know some information about the speed, and the kinematic analysis step will give you that. If you have two particles, maybe you'll be able to derive a relationship between the speed of the two particles, or you will be able to relate the velocities with something else, some other parameter in the system. Step four is to draw free body diagram in an intermediate position. So why do I say in an intermediate position? You don't want to draw this free body diagram in a special situation, in a special setting for the particle or the system, because maybe in a special setting certain forces are zero. Maybe you have a spring force, okay, and that spring force would be zero when the spring is not stretched or not compressed. And if you choose to draw free body diagram in that situation, in that position, then the forces from the spring forces would not show up. On the other hand, if you choose a generic intermediate position where all the forces are acting, then you can clearly see that there are forces whose work you would have to take into account. Step 5 is to identify forces that do and do not do any work. So, for example, if you can clearly see that there is a normal reaction which is perpendicular direction displacement, then you know that force is not going to do any work. So, you wouldn't have to worry about that particular force. Among the forces that do any work, you have two possibilities. You have forces which could be conservative, and you would need to identify them as well, and the forces that may be non-conservative. So, in this category belongs gravity, elastic forces, and there may be more. And among the non-conservative would be the unknown forces. So unknown forces, like you have a particle and there is a force P applied on it. We don't know what the nature of this P is. So this would also belong to a non-conservative force, as well as friction force. Okay. Then the next step is to see if you are going to use the general equation, which says that work done by all the forces equal to change in kinetic energy, or you can use conservation of mechanical energy principle. So this is going to be valid only if all forces are conservative. On the other hand, this equation is general, which means that you can use this if you have a combination of forces which are conservative as well as non-conservative. Now, either of these two equations, this or this, will allow you to solve only for one unknown, because these are the scalar equations. So there's only one equation, which means you can at most solve for one unknown. If you have a multi-particle system, then you can write this equation for each particle. You can also write this equation for a system of particles. So in that case, you may have more than one equation. And of course, the last step would be to identify the unknowns and solve for them from either this or this equation. At this point, maybe the problem might also ask you to find certain kinds of forces, maybe certain kinds of acceleration, and you can still use Newton's second law in conjunction with the work energy approach.